This is the zeroth order, and we have calculated, we have shown that, have seen that below the transition point one comes to the long range order. Above, these are already somehow fluctuations. Above, one gets exponential behavior. That's the major difference between ordered and disordered phase. So for the ordered phase, you have long range order. For disordered phase, you have some order at short distances, but then this disappears. So now I sketch what really people know how to do if one is near the transition. What is the problem of criticality? And then to understand this problem, one can understand better how this problem has been resolved. And then it will be clear, more clear what new has appeared in this theory. So, perturbation theory. This is again what I talk about now is the development of, I would say, 60s just. Today, this is development in 60s and beginning of 70s. So, perturbation theory. How one does perturbation theory? Again, I want to concentrate on the correlation function of two magnetic moments, and this correlation function in the lowest order, neglecting interaction between magnetic moments, is written here. Now we have this free energy functional, which is C gradient M squared plus A M squared plus B half M squared. And we simply expand calculating this correlation function M0 M R. Calculating this average, we calculate such a functional integral f naught plus f interaction divided by t dm. The free energy functional. This is C grad M squared plus A M squared and dr and f interaction is equal to B half into M squared dr. So it's easy to guess. That if we know how to calculate this integral with interaction term equal to zero, putting interaction term equal to zero, then in order to calculate it or find it interaction term, we should just expand the terms of this f interaction. This is just standard procedure of perturbation theory. And what? Where is the problem? Why near the phase transitions one encounters a problem? And this problem is of a divergent integrals. And there is very often people think that it is the best. Think when integrals are well defined, convergent, and so on. But sometimes one can hear a little bit more interesting saying that It's much better when integrals diverge. Then if they diverge, one can hope to have to have a new physical effect and to study. If everything converges, this is just boring, this is dull situation, and one should hope to have diverging integrals. And now this is just the case. If one had in this perturbation theory always converging integrals, then this would mean that just conventional Landau theory of phase transition is valid. If one gets at some point diverging integrals, then one should hope that something new appears, and it does. So, how to calculate this perturbation theory? Okay, of course, to do it, it's good to have a basic knowledge about diagrammatic expansions. Okay, I will try to. I don't know how many people do not know. Never worked with perturbation theory. You never?
I'm just doing for the people.
Okay, no, my feeling is that
you should do it.
They heard about it.
Well, okay, sure, but give a bit of details.
Okay, so then I make expansion. So, first order. But this is strange. These are already PhD students, not undergraduates.
They probably heard about it, but I think it doesn't hurt. It doesn't hurt to redo something like that.
Okay. So, zeroth order has been calculated. Then we calculate the first order, which means that we expand in this term, so we write here minus F interaction divided by T and exponential minus F and here not divided by T, and we have also the corresponding term in the denominator, 1 minus here the m and here the m. So I just expanded. This is first order correction. What should I do after that? I should calculate. So this is what we had previously. And then what is this? And I should write integral here also over, so which is f of r, which is also function of r here. That's fine. So I write it explicitly. MrM0, and then I write this f interaction. This should be integral V half and here M R 1 squared and M this squared V 1 and this is the first term and average 0 and then I have this is minus and here b plus and the integral naught. Then this is 0 and there will be the term m squared 1 squared and one, and this average means the integral minus f naught divided by t, and here the integral minus f naught divided by t, dm, means averaging with the functional, with this bare functional f naught. So these are two terms that one gets here. This comes from the denominator, and this is this numerator. These are terms of the first order. So this is first order. Complete silence means wood. Understood, or some explanations are demanded. No, I have written the only thing that here I have written this interaction term. This is B1 half and this R1, an integral over R1. Okay. It will be exact. I write here also temperature. And this term is just expansion of this denominator. That's it. So, then the calculation. So this calculation of Gaussian integrals is the most pleasant job, in the sense that one doesn't need to think, and one should use so-called weak theorem. Weak theorem, which means just rules of calculation of Gaussian integrals. So this means that if one has such an average, Gaussian average, which means m, and I write here squared 1, so I write it 4 times, and here again m r1, m r1, and average. So how to calculate the Gaussian average of this product? The recipe is very simple, and it can be immediately checked using Fourier transform, for example, that you compose all possible pairs. So you take such a pair, for example, this pair between these two, and all possible pairs here. So by pair, I mean that you will have such an average. So instead of calculating the entire Gaussian integral, you make all permutations, you compose all possible pairs of m. And each pair you replace by average. That's the weak theorem, or just Gaussian rules for calculating Gaussian integrals. And then you have all those averages. Now, what is very important, and it originates from Feynman, who has introduced diagrammatic rules for calculating actually Gaussian integrals using green functions. So actually what is written here, mr, m0, is a green function. So this correlation function is a green function for this theory with interaction. And instead of course one can make all these pairs, replace these pairs by this average, and this average is just what we have calculated already. This is this integral exponential ek r divided by c k squared plus a d dk. So one calculates all possible averages, and we know these averages, what they are. So, but it was invented in field theory, a nice method of green functions, diagrammatic techniques. And this diagrammatic techniques is something like language. So if you want to explain, if you, for example, are in some countries and you don't know language of local people, you nowadays try to speak English. It doesn't always help, but you may try. So this diagrammatic technique is something like that. Instead of showing, writing explicitly the integrals, you draw some pictures. And these pictures are already something that people from completely different disciplines of physics understand very easily. In this sense, for example, condensed matter physicists and high energy physicists can understand each other very easily because these Feynman diagrams look very similar, although very often, although of course the meaning for each diagram, for each green function is different, but nevertheless one understands very easily. So now look at this diagram, how one can make pairings. For example, this pairing. What is that? This is here, and I make all possible pair and denote each correlation function here, M, R, M, not. I denote it by line. So, therefore, if I take this pair, I make this pair. This is this one, 0, R, and this one. I make all possible pairs, but they are of that type. I have one point, R1, and I have these lines coming to this point, and I integrate over all coordinates R1. So this is not interesting diagram because it cancels by this average. So I made this pairing, and this is just this one. So therefore, this is zero. These are so-called not connected, non-connected diagrams. They should be neglected. More interesting are pairings of that type, for example. This one, this one, or one can make this one, so here this one, and then this one here, and this way. So there are two possibilities. And these possibilities can be actually, they lead to the same integrals, although with different coefficients. So this is this diagram. So one has 0, one has R, one has R1, and here one integrates over R1 in such a way. And this diagram one writes with some coefficients, just G naught, and here, so I denote it as G naught. G naught 0 R1, and then G naught R1 R, and here G R1 R1. So this is how one calculates the first order diagram, just writing on such an integral G naught. So each time one simply has to calculate the green function in the zeroth approximation without interactions, and then insert into the diagram and calculate the integral. So this is the way how one explains, or when two theorists talk to each other, they explain most often what they do in such a term. So I calculate this diagram, or I sum some class of diagrams, and so on. Now, the question again, how to calculate those integrals. One can go to the second order, this is first order. One can go to the second order, and in the second order one has already several diagrams. One can do this one, one can do this one, plus one can have this one diagram, plus one can have such diagram. What else? I think that's it. So, and then one using completely different topological properties of such diagrams. For example, this one can be cut into two parts, just cutting one Green function. And this is using Dyson formula. This is just summation of geometric series, and this is just self-energy. This diagram is less trivial, and this diagram is even more complicated. In principle, then, according to all this diagrammatic technique, so of course I'm not able to explain details of all those things. I just sketch what exists in this direction. So one can represent the sum of all such diagrams. One can say that this is G is equal to 1 divided by G naught minus 1 minus sigma. And sigma is self-energy. So sigma self-energy. And this self-energy in this case is just this one. This is here. In principle, here one can also simplify the things and say that, for example, one can write these diagrams like some bubble, and here this way. And this is called, this bubble called vertex. And one can, instead of studying all such diagrams for the Green functions, it's very often it's important to study vertices. And vertex for these two diagrams is clearly, so this one can be written as this one. This is, for example, for this diagram. Or one can write also for this diagram in the same way. So therefore, for vertices, one has different diagrams of these types. And already on the level of vertices, one can see what happens, why the integrals diverge in the theory of phase transitions, and how to work with that. So, and studying vertices, one encounters again infinite series of diagrams. So I must warn that in all these diagrammatic expansions, one usually has a series of contributions, and they are so usually one cannot sum all of them. And one sums very often the most dangerous, the most relevant, and so on. This diagrammatic technique helps to proceed in this direction. For example, if I want to calculate this bubble, it's again, one has just bare interaction, plus that what I have written, this fish, plus next orders, it can be this diagram, it can be this diagram, and so on. And now we come to the point. What is bad in this expansion? We can consider just the simplest diagram.
Sorry, but you are summing diagrams which don't have all the same number of external legs?
Well, they do.
Yeah.
These are the legs.
These are the legs, yeah.
Okay, and then the simplest diagram. What is that? If you take all external momenta for simplicity, let us take all external momenta equal to zero, then this diagram is the integral of the time. dk, and here ck squared plus a squared. So what happens at a large momenta, as I have mentioned, usually in condensed matter it is not an interesting question because we always have short distances, well-defined short distances, minimal distances like lattice constants, and therefore we assume that at high momenta everything should be cut by the inverse lattice constant. At the same time, if you calculate this integral taking into account a low momenta, which is relevant because A, we understand that A vanishes at the phase transition, and then we can say that this integral, when A equals zero, this integral is finite when d is larger than 4. And this integral diverges. So this integral diverges dk divided by ck squared. This integral diverges from d. So, what can one tell about this exercise, from this exercise? In principle, here you have the interaction constant squared. So, if interaction constant squared is small, for this one you have b, for this one you have b squared. So, therefore, if this integral converges, then that's fine. Perturbation theory is perfect. So, we can calculate all higher order diagrams, and we will get high orders of B and each time divergent, convergent integrals, and therefore fluctuations are small. So, then one concludes Landau theory is valid. And DC equals 4 is called upper critical dimension. So, therefore, Landau theory is not something which is never valid. Definitely is valid for dimensions higher than 4. And dimension equal 4, effectively this dimension is possible. This is first case when this theory was considered using renormalization group equations, or in that case for d equal 4, this is logarithmic theory. And this logarithmic theory, this parquet, so this was approximation with so-called parquet equations. And one could solve everything for d equal 4. This was the work of Larkin and Unitsky. It was, I guess, 68 or 69 maybe. So this was the first work when for the phase transition was really everything was solved. And then actually, but below 4, one has a really strong divergence and one cannot do any perturbation theory. And then, so one encounters a situation when each diagram is more and more divergent than the previous one, and simply that's the problem of phase transition, critical region, that really one cannot calculate using perturbation theory. That something happens, integrals diverge, something new happens. And this new is what is called scaling theory. Okay, this scaling theory, of course, doesn't work for one dimension. In one dimension, you don't have any transition. So I would say the scaling theory is for D equals 3. If one speaks of real dimensions. So therefore, all these divergences lead to scaling theory. I already have mentioned the beginning of this scaling theory. And then you don't have parameters, small parameter to make expansions. You have everything divergent. And the only possibility to do something, except, of course, numerical simulations. In 60s, beginning of 70s, numerical simulations were not so good. Then there were different methods based on high temperature, low temperature expansions. And finally, it is due to Kenneth Wilson, who really suggested to consider a fractional dimension. So, this is Wilson theory, and actually for this theory here, I guess it was 71 or 72, I don't remember exactly. It was really something shock for people. I remember that time that he suggested that D equals 3, how to calculate this D equals 3. He suggested that D equals 3 is equal to 4 minus epsilon, 4 epsilon equals 1, which is of course true, but what was more than that, it was suggested that let us calculate everything for epsilon small. Theory for epsilon much smaller than unity. And it turns out that expansion in terms of the interaction constant is impossible, but it turns out that one can do a renormalization group analysis. So one can do it in 4 dimensions, but one can do it also for small epsilon. One can write renormalization group equations. And proceeding in this way, one can calculate everything for small epsilon. This was the idea of Wilson. Again, if I will start doing all those things now, it will take too much time. Therefore, again, I simply sketch what is known about quantum critical phenomena, but in order to go into details, one should read books, and I guess this lab was famous for, and is famous for studying this quantum phase these phase transitions using the normalization group and so on. So therefore, you have chance not only to read something but to ask people who were in the beginning of all these things. So the point is that for epsilon small, one can solve everything and prove scaling. Which means that, for example, this correlation of magnetic moments is some at the transition, so A equals to zero, at the transition is some power law, with some coefficient alpha. And this, and all other functions, specific heat have, all those functions have different powers. And the scaling means that when you have these correlation functions, power law correlation functions, you don't have any scale. So if you write exponential, then you have here the scale RC. But RC diverges. So RC diverges as 1 over some this A, some other function, or some other power. So we have seen that in three dimensions it diverges as square root of A. And A, I remind you, A is this C minus T minus TC divided by TC. Nevertheless, and the point is that using this 4 minus epsilon expansion, one can really calculate all those exponents using expansion in epsilon. So everything can be done, and the recipe by Wilson was, so let us calculate with small epsilon, and at the end we just put epsilon equals 1. And then we are in our dimension where we live. So that was the recipe. And that time it was really very shocking. What does it mean to work in fractional dimension? In principle, it is not difficult. You simply write integrals. For example, such integral, and here I write square. And you can calculate all possible integrals just writing everywhere d. So that's somehow this is something like k to the power d minus 1, and here ck squared. So, and therefore, in such integrals, you simply write the proper power, and then you take d is equal to 4 minus epsilon, and you expand in epsilon, and in this case you have logarithmic theory, and you write the normalization group equations. And so, proceeding in this way, one comes to all possible power law behavior, and it was concluded that for the phase transitions, what should be done with the Landau theory, just to change these exponents. For example, in Landau theory, this exponent was 1/2 for d equals 3, but if you use this 4 minus epsilon expansion, you get some other power, so I don't want to list all results. People calculated it in first order, in second order for epsilon, and I guess
five.
Okay.
You are second order.
No.
It
was the Russian group, and then it was checked that there was a slight error, and it was checked by a German professor, Kleinhardt.
So he calculated up to 5 orders. So I
don't. But yeah, there was a slight error in the first version of the Russian group.
Okay, the problem is that all these series are not convergent but asymptotic. Like, for example, all perturbation theory series are asymptotic. And for example, and one, this means that this terms of the series first decay and then grow. For example, in electrodynamics, asymptotic theories are very good. And usually, if you calculate more and more before the series, the terms of the series start growing, everything is perfect. In quantum electrodynamics, you have a small parameter 1 over 137. So therefore, for quantum electrodynamics, you are safe to calculate up to the order of 137 and everything will be fine. You will get more and more accuracy. Therefore, in quantum electrodynamics, the accuracy is fantastic. Here in this theory, when you make expansion in epsilon, you don't have any other small parameter. Actually, this epsilon expansion, this epsilon expansion is good when these corrections are still small when you put epsilon equals 1. I guess second order is still very good, but I do not know, Ricardo, do you remember coefficients at 5th order? Okay, so.
Is the large order behavior of the series known? Is the large order behavior of these
Yes. You mean asymptotic behavior?
Asymptotic of the coefficient, yes.
Asymptotics. In principle, there is a development due to Lipatov, who suggested calculating asymptotical behavior as reducing it to calculation of some instantons.
But that's for perturbation theory.
Perturbation.
The coupling constant, not here.
Not here. I'm not sure that I'm aware about asymptotics in this epsilon expansion. In principle, of course, one can calculate the same exponents if, as soon as one is sure that these are power law behavior, and this power law behavior follows from renormalization group treatment. If one is sure that it is just power, one can use this high temperature expansions and then with Padé approximants calculate. So there are different ways of calculating these exponents, and I guess as concerns numerical values of these exponents, the knowledge is quite good. So I do not know if it is so important to know the exact value of the exponent with the accuracy of thousands or whatever, but I guess the agreement exists. As also now with this possibility of computer simulations doing Monte Carlo, one can really get good knowledge of the exponents. But the point is, what is important for us is the following, that actually conventional criticality implies that first, we have Landau theory, but actually, if we are close to the transition, we always must calculate contributions of fluctuations. And as the result of these contributions, one gets scaling behavior. Scaling behavior, this means that physical quantities can be written in terms of the closeness to the transition, this A. If you are at the transition, you can write dependence on the coordinates, and each time you get some power law with some corresponding exponent. The same can be done below the transition. There you have the magnetic moment, and the magnetic moment will already be proportional not to 1/2 as in the Landau theory. So M should be proportional to some power A, and here some beta. And beta is 1/2 for the Landau theory. But it depends on symmetries of the system, but it is not equal to 1/2, it is somewhat different. Although, even the good thing about this epsilon expansion was that if you put epsilon equals 1, still corrections to the Landau theory are not large. And then one can say that even for epsilon equals 1, it is not a very large correction, and therefore everything is fine. So therefore, the main point is that you get power law behaviors. That's the basics, and these exponents do not depend on the strength of interaction, they depend only on universal properties of the system. So how many components has the vector of magnetization or those things? So it depends on symmetry. So exponents are universal. And if we speak about criticality, critical behavior near the phase transition, one usually has in mind power law behavior, scaling relations, and so that's how the form, in this form, this theory exists since the 70s. I guess that the crucial was this 4 minus epsilon expansion by Wilson, who really proved the existence of so-called fixed points in the Galvan law equations, and these fixed points determined the exponents. And the possibility, the very possibility of writing Galvan law function was due to the fact that epsilon is small. So this is the general theory of classical criticality. Okay, maybe it's a good point to stop it for today, and next time I will be speaking of already quantum criticality. So, questions? Okay, so I believe that it was understandable, if not trivial. If too trivial, then I apologize for that.